to our special election series, Political Roots. We believe that most of us are shaped and formed by our college years. The years when our first ideological moorings really take root, when our first embrace of politics or interest in the world around us begins. Also, it's a critical time and a critical generation. Take a look at the statistics in this election. An estimated 2.3 crore voters are between the ages of 18 and 19. 47% of India's electorate is under the age of 35. So on this special election series, we take prominent politicians back to their alma mater, to their old colleges, to face young voters that we believe will have a critical voice in this election. On Political Roots today, it's time to rewind the clock. We're broadcasting today from St. Stephen's College, of which, of course, I am an alumni as well. One has to make full disclosure. And let's introduce our guest to you tonight as we bring our lights down. Political Roots tonight from St. Stephen's College. Thirty-five years before he would contest his first ever election to become Member of Parliament, there was a much tougher race to run and win. It was in 1974 that Shashi Tharoor successfully became president of the Students' Union at St. Stephen's College in Delhi.
He was largely in the classroom, on the stage. He had a tremendous love for public speaking, on English theatre, writing a magazine in the college. And then he went on to be the president of the Students' Union in the college.
I, Shashi Tharoor, do swear in the name of God.
But the celebrations that erupted in the corridors of college still did not anticipate a political career for the man who went on to become an eminent author, a diplomat, an academician, and of course, a cricket lover. Many, many avatars before the political one would take root.
Shashi had a lot of girlfriends, and which used to be a source of both amusement and no small amount of envy among all of us. I'd never expected Shashi to join politics, but I was happy when he did. There's some parts of his ideology that I may agree with less, but I think Shashi's conviction about India's secularism and pluralism is very strong and robust, and politically that sort of connects me with him as well.
College was still 1 year away from opening its doors to women and going co-ed. Staging Shakespeare in those days needed the help of the fine women from Delhi's Miranda House. Shashi Tharoor famously played Antony to Meera Nair's Cleopatra. By the time the women did arrive in college as fellow students, Tharoor, they say, was already the stuff of legend.
I've known Shashi Tharoor, or I've known of him actually, since I joined St. Stephen's College, which was in 1976. We were the so-called second batch of girls. And Shashi Tharoor by then was already a legend. He was known as the good-looking senior who'd been, you know, acting in Shakespeare in plays with the Shakespeare Society, and he was the best debater. So the blue-eyed boy, literally.
The first batch of women at St. Stephen's College had to climb an enormously high mountain of resistance from the boys. Leading the opposition to their entry, something he sheepishly admits today was the wrong cause to bat for, was Chandan Mitra, also running for president of the union 1 year after Shashi Tharoor.
As he was known for his fiery rhetoric and his oratory, and he was perhaps also rhetoric, and he was an extremely good speaker and a very fluent speaker. And he was, again, a star debater. And every time Chandan walked through the corridors of St. Stephen's College, a hush would fall, and, you know, all of us freshers would see, oh, there goes Chandan Mitra.
Those debating years at St. Stephen's perhaps paved the way for Chandan's nightly television appearances 3 decades later. Chandan Mitra's politics took root in college, but on the opposite end of the ideological spectrum that he would eventually end up on.
We had a deep and passionate interest in everything political. I think both of us at one level shared this deep commitment to politics, and that's continued, and it's been one of the real bond between us. I can remember a time during the 1971 general election, and we were in the final year of our school days, and we had a mock general election in our class. Chandan at that time was a great supporter of Indira Gandhi, and he led the team to speak on behalf of the Congress, and I spoke on behalf of the Janasangh.
His flair for Hindi, something that would hold him in good stead in his later embrace of politics, also began in these years.
I cannot deliver a speech in Hindi. I can understand it fluently. But Chandan, who with his great and abiding love for the Hindi cinema, actually picked up his entire Hindi on the basis of watching more than 100 films in a year. And then he had this obsession in college and in school of each week, I forget which day of the week it was, where he would listen to the Binaka Geet Mala, which was broadcast from Radio Ceylon in those days, and compile a sort of Hindi top of the pops list.
Today we routinely see them spar and jostle on the nightly news. But once upon a time, not so long ago, these were two men shaped by the common ethos of one college.
Shashi Tharoor and Chandan Mitra, opposite ends of the political spectrum, but may the two best men win.
On political roots, taking them back to where it all began, compatriots once, opponents today, Shashi Tharoor and Chandan Mitra. All right, so we have today, they're opponents today, they were friends once. Let's have a big round of applause for political roots. Shashi Tharoor, Chandan Mitra, friends turned political foes, not personal foes, it should be said. And it is such a pleasure to have both of you on the program this evening. Let me start by asking you, it's quite unusual, by the way, for our young friends here. Both Shashi and Chandan have been president of the St. Stephen Students Union in their time, in consecutive years. But is it true, Chandan, and I don't know if you'll politically ever live this down, that you were the campaign manager for Shashi Tharoor's election campaign?
There's nothing to live down, yes. I was proud. And I believe he won because of me. So, I'm very happy to have helped him. And I still remember a comment he made when he was going off to contest the UN Secretary General's position, which unfortunately he lost. When he came back, he said that one of the reasons we met at a lunch, where he was telling his seniors that he thinks he lost that election because he didn't have me as the campaign manager.
So you're saying later on in life, Shashi Tharoor needed your help?
Well, no, I was also needing, he's a very competent man. He doesn't need anybody's help. But certainly every person, especially if you're going into electoral politics, you need somebody dependable, somebody who can help you strategize, help you focus. And Shashi had so many multifarious interests that, you know, I think I acted as some kind of a chaperone, kind of keeping him on the straight and narrow path, so which went helped him to win an election by a record margin.
Shashi, did Chandan keep you on the straight and narrow? I think that's a very, that is loaded with all kinds of meanings.
No, I was very straight, but not very narrow. And that's where I think Chandan, actually, I must admit, he was the one who first came up with the idea that I must contest. He was the strategist and the tactician. I mean, one of his master strokes during the campaign, which no one had anticipated, was, you know, traditionally in college in those days, and forgive me if it's all very different now, but in those days was that the science block was largely absent from the political fray. It was Chandan had the master stroke that we should actually tap into the science block, which no one had done. So we got a whole bunch of votes from the science block that no one had ever got before. And that certainly boosted the record margin that Chandan
spoke about. And were both of you good left of center young
no,
men?
No, that is the amusing thing, actually. Chandan, I think by then, was very much, if he was at all an Indira Gandhi admirer, he was very much to the left of Indira Gandhi. Whereas I had, if anything, my leanings were towards the Swatantra Party. I was this liberal,
so you were
free
enterprise. Right of center, economic.
Exactly. I was never a Jansanghi or a BJP type. You know, the interesting thing, and I'm sure that's still the case, was that St. Stephen's College was totally non-political. Our union, yeah. We refrained from joining the Delhi University yes. Students Union. I believe that was still the case.
Yeah.
In fact, when I was elected president of St. Stephen's, the president of the Delhi University Students Union was a certain Arun Jaitley. And we go back to those days. And of course, I made it clear to Arun we were not going to participate in his activities, but he became a friend. We talked and engaged. Chandan had lots of talents. And in fact, one of the ironies of Chandan's presidency is that he actually was an unelected president because the emergency came along and he was appointed as president. I think he would have won the election in his own right, but he never had a chance to contest one.
Well, he's getting ready to contest his first Lok Sabha election,
exactly,
by the way,
it's the same story.
From Hooghly.
It's the same
story. So that's
story.
Going to be interesting, Chandan.
That's but actually the first election I'll actually be contesting.
So when you have to fight on television, does it feel weird? Because like you go back such a long way.
No, now we have to take political positions. And many of the things we say on TV, neither he is, I'm sure, nor do
I. I mean everything I say.
That's honest. But come on, you don't believe everything.
I believe everything I say, but I don't think I've ever.
Today you have to defend Indira Gandhi. Your writings are there criticizing her. That's one thing.
I'm not defending Indira Gandhi. I'm defending Sonia Gandhi, Rahul Gandhi.
Not Indira Gandhi.
No, I don't defend the emergency, basically.
Was that a problem for you when you embraced the Congress?
Some people tried to make it a problem. In fact, the two sets of people tried to make it a problem. First, those within the party who didn't want me sort of coming in and taking what perhaps they saw as their rightful due.
Yeah.
And so many photocopies were made of relevant pages of India from midnight to the millennium.
Yeah.
And
were you scathing about Indira?
Yeah. And then the...
And are you still able to be scathing about Indira Gandhi?
No, but you see, Sonia Gandhi and Rahul Gandhi both knew about this. It's not that I had concealed my previous positions. And they understood. And then during the elections in Kerala, we have this tradition of debates like this.
Yeah.
Where the opponents will in a public square and there'll be an audience and TV cameras. And the CPI would religiously station a lawyer on the front row with copies of the Malayalam edition of India from Midnight to the Millennium, and he would always stand up and read a passage. To which my answer became unfailingly, look, I'm contesting the elections of 2009, not the elections of 1977. End of story.
So ironically, you were a fan of Indira Gandhi.
There has been an evolution in my politics. I have gone through several transformations. I was a leftist at one stage. Indira Gandhi has supported, and I still have a regard for her, because of a strong nationalist embodiment. She was an embodiment of nationalism.
71, and, we all
yeah, 71. We, and that actually made me a fan of her, 71. But the emergency came as a big break. A disappointment, a shock. And I don't think that I have ever, never supported Indira Gandhi thereafter. I worked in 77 for the Janata Party. In the university, we had formed a group. And we went and went about collecting volunteers. And if I can make a confession, long time, years have passed. Since the Congress people had left the booth in Kamalanagar and ran away by 3 o'clock in the afternoon, we just took over the booth, and in one that election alone, I voted 49 times, I counted.
What?
I stamped 49 ballot
That's
papers.
That's 48 more than I've been able to vote.
Okay, I want to start taking audience questions. Sameer Gardner. Sameer, where are you? Yes, go ahead with your question. Yeah.
Good evening, sir. My question is for Mr. Tharoor. Sir, given that Stephen's is seen as a prestigious institution and a privileged seat in the country, do you think in an avenue like politics, it could backfire, especially given that when the opposition can latch on to things like the Chaiwala statement?
You mean Manishankar Iyer's remark?
Exactly. So do you think that could actually be a problem, the idea of not being close to the masses, being a Stephenian?
Shashi, Mani had this famous story where he said, as he entered the logbook in college after Natwar Singh said, I owe everything I am to college. And Mani wrote, why blame the college? Now, is it time to reverse that question when it comes to Manishankar Iyer, where we are routinely accused of utterly Stephenian snobbery? And let me put this to the audience again. Those of you who believe what Mr. Manishankar Iyer said was in good taste, raise your hand. Was it in good taste?
Does
not a
Manishankar
single
Iyer
hand.
Does say anything that is in good taste?
Now look,
ever?
Money.
But this answer tells
allows
you
his wit to run away with him. Sometimes the wit exceeds the judgment. I mean, he said things at all our expenses, including mine. I mean, money is somebody who does say things because they're funny or because they're clever, not
but
because they're
But does he have a
wealthy.
Point that there is this
but
kind
no,
of
money
classist
is not that
snobbery,
typical. Money is not
the
that.
Ivory tower of
money
St.
making
Stephen's
a comment
College.
About Ajay Markin's English not being a Ramjas College. That kind of thing, very few Stephenians do that. That's money, that's not Stephenia. And let me say something. I mean, Ajay Markin's a colleague and a friend, so it's not because of that. I'm just saying, I've actually written in a very different context when I was asked to expatiate on the St. Stephen School of Literature way before I came into politics. And I argued passionately against those critics who are arguing that Stephenian writers were all elitist and detached from the Indian reality and so on. And I argued, first of all, the Stephenian elitism was always an elitism of merit. The people we were proud of are the ones who actually aced the IFS and IAS exams, the ones who were toppers in university. It was always merit that we used to celebrate. It was never money, finance. No one used to give a damn about how much your father earned or whatever. It was all about merit. All of those factors mattered far more in college than which class you were, which religion you practiced, which caste you were from, and so on.
So you're saying it was a healthy elitism?
It was a healthy elitism.
Is there such a thing, Chandan? Is there such a thing? Because a lot of us have had to unlearn what we learnt in college. Much as we love it, we've actually had to unlearn a lot of assumptions as well. Today, when you're in a party where, let's say, a Narendra Modi, attacked for his origins for being the son of a tea vendor, that's, I think, been condemned even by the Congress. But then you have a Salman Khurshid, also from St. Stephen's, who will say Napunsak, will use a word like that, then Rahul Gandhi will come and condemn it. But Mr. Modi himself, for example, did invoke his caste in his recent rally. He did say that he did invoke his OBC identity, and a lot of people found that contradictory, and they said that if Mr. Modi is running a campaign that is not about identity politics, then why did he stress his caste?
You know, caste is a factor in India. It is a very important factor, particularly in the Hindi-speaking states, UP and Bihar. And when you have to explain your position where you are, many people believe Mr. Modi must be a very, you know, because he has an imposing figure and speaks very well. People think that he is a
so-called upper caste.
Uchakoti Brahman. He's not. And he's very proud of the fact that he belongs to a very backward community. Stephens also, we believed always in that. A lot of people came, and they came under various, there was no quota system of this rigidity as you have now. But there were people from quotas, there were people from backward, economically weaker sections. And in a sense, the kind of elitism that Shashi is talking about provided that kind of benchmark. Everybody strive to reach that benchmark.
Exactly.
Don't forget that the Maoist movement also virtually began in St. Stephen's College. And people from here, who were actually quite stupid of them, they ran away to some village in Bihar and thought that they will bring revolution there. But when we joined college, there was an atmosphere of, you know, this very, very strong egalitarianism and that we have to be with the poor. Tariq Ali once came and addressed an audience in this auditorium, overflowing right up to the Allnut Gate. And so there was a very strong left and egalitarian sentiment also running high along with elitism.
The next question, Aditya Guha. Aditya Guha, where are you?
Yeah, my question is to Chandan Mitra, that does the BJP want an egalitarian democracy or a pluralistic democracy? And your views on the same. And I have one question to Mr. Tharoor as well, that why do we want to vote for the Congress party when we have so many scams and so many, let's say, negative publicity about the party going on right now, only as a secular alternative to the options present?
Sadly, there is corruption in our society, and I fear everyone here probably has experienced it to a greater or lesser degree. But it's not the monopoly of any one party. Sadly, corruption has been a phenomenon of many governments, state and central. What's different now is two things. One, the institutions of our system are working well to expose wrongdoing, the CAG and others. Second, our media has completely proliferated. If the same phenomenon existed 15 years ago when the scandals of the BJP government and the Tehelka scan stings operated, you'd be saying the same thing to the BJP you're saying
to
the Congress.
I can't respond to that, but would you concede that secularism,
on secularism
by itself?
On secularism, our point is, for 65 years this country has been built on a certain idea of India, 67 years this year. And that idea of India is an all-embracing one, that it doesn't matter what the color of your skin is, what caste you are, what religion you practice, you basically have the same rights in this country. You're
but
Indian.
The Samajwadi Party
but
was considered a secular party after Muzaffar Nagar. Is Mulayam Singh Yadav a secular leader for you?
He's a secular leader who's clearly made some serious lapses of governance.
So when Mulayam Singh Yadav has riots on his watch, he's a secular leader who's made mistakes. But when Mr. Modi has riots on his watch, he's a communal leader.
The big difference is, how did Mr. Modi behave when those riots were happening? There's simply too much out there suggesting that at the very least he condoned the violence, if not actually led it.
This is not the forum, at least I didn't think it was the forum. But I must say, you know, just when you talked about how Mr. Modi behaved and how Mr. Mulayam Singh Yadav behaved, Shashi, your memory can't be that limited to not remember Sci-Fi Festival was happening just at that point, and Bollywood stars were dancing and prancing all over the place, even while all the riot victims of Muzaffarnagar, mainly of the minority community, were out in the cold, children were dying, and nobody was visiting them. And so I don't think that, you know, this, I think the question is entirely right. The secularism is a very useful stick to beat your opponent with. And those who are with us are secularists. Those who are against
us. But does the BJP have a problem in its relationship with India's Muslim voter? But the fact of the matter is that beyond Gujarat, you have not been able to get the Muslim voter to respond to you. Your party president is apologizing for anticipatory mistakes, not for 2002.
I don't understand what these apologies and they serve the media's appetite. And you can run many shows and talk through the nights many times. But frankly, it's through your work that you must prove. And you see the condition of Muslims in Gujarat, which even the Sachar Commission has certified.
Do you believe secularism is politically relevant?
I have always said, Barkha, in many of your shows, that the secular communal divide is a hoax. It does not exist. It must not exist because we have to strive towards social and egalitarianism.
Let me put it to the audience. Those of you who believe secularism is an election issue, but do you believe that secularism is a political issue? Do you think it matters in the elections? Oh, it matters in the elections. I've got some hands saying it does matter. Put your hands down. I want to now say those who think it doesn't matter. Those who think it doesn't matter. Fewer hands saying it doesn't matter. Let's take a comment here. Why do you think it does not matter?
Not in these elections per se. I mean, I don't think that it did not matter from the past, but it mattered earlier, but doesn't matter now. Because as he pointed out in his question, after all that sort of Congress has been involved in the past, in the UPA too, I don't think that they can invoke secularism as an issue against the BJP now.
Does it bother you that there is a major contestant claiming the desire to be Prime Minister of India who is not someone who subscribes to the same idea of India as the constitution built and as we've all lived with for all these decades? Because that's one thing Chandan really is going to have a problem denying, is the fact that the BJP is built on bigotry, that there is a constant transmission of
serious
signals
exception
against a particular community.
I think serious
in
exception.
Speeches. All right, then
the Congress party or one family has no monopoly over this so-called idea of India. It is not your idea of India with which I have to agree.
The phrase is Tagore's. It goes back to somebody we both admire.
You can quote many.
It's an idea that is inclusive.
I can quote, you know, or many Thiruvallavar and other South Indian saints whom you will be able to
Subramanya Bharati.
But Shashi, before many of the people here were even born, you did have the Rajiv Gandhi government reversing the Shah Bano verdict on alimony for Muslim women. So the Congress's own record is also problematic. I think what people look at is the secularism has been abused by politicians of all parties. And therefore, it's lack of credibility as a political construct. Would you at least concede that?
No, I don't, because it's a little more complicated than that. First of all, is how we define secularism in the first place, which has evolved also since Nehruji spoke of secularism very much as sort of an absence of religion, whereas secularism in Indian political practice has come to mean a profusion of religions, toleration of all of them, including some of their eccentricities. It's therefore a different practice. I don't think Nehruji would have done the Shah Bano law.
Was the revocation of the Shah Bano judgment right, in your opinion?
In my view, no. I've said so in India for midnight the millennium. But the point is not that, again, we're not fighting the issues of the 1980s. It's 30 years later, we have a future to build.
But they all contribute to the build-up of a distortion of secularism in the political space.
No, but my argument is very different, Barkha. My argument is, when you have one political party that has nakedly, from its very choice of color, chosen to identify itself to
it is a sacred Indian color.
I'm a Hindu. I'm proud to have saffron.
So,
but I'm not signaling with I have saffron, green
flag,
and white.
The national flag has saffron.
So I have saffron, green and white.
No.
And blue for that matter. All colors are mine.
BJP has saffron and green, by the way. You probably haven't seen the flag
at
all.
The leaf under the lotus.
Right to the bottom you'll have saffron. Let's not quibble over this. Then you will say proportional representation quota system in the flag also.
Chandan, I told you he always had this.
All right,
proportions are actually equal in the flag, as you probably have noticed.
No, but what's wrong with saffron?
I love saffron. I'm just saying you can't only signal saffron. But from the choice of that to things like the way in which Modi speaks in his speeches and refers to Muslims with this exaggerated phrase, Mia, Mia, Ahmed Bhai, Mia, this and that.
This
signals about
Congress has also done a lot of things.
You feel sorry about the Gujarat riots like driving over a puppy. I mean, what are these signals to the Indian public? There's a very unmistakable subtext coming through, which is one of bigotry and contempt for an entire community.
People are not believing you. And that's why this is happening. There is a wave of revulsion against the Congress today, as this gentleman rightly brought out. So, no matter how strongly you kind of attack every twist and turn in Modi's phraseology, it shows a sign of desperation.
Next question, Madhvi Jha. Madhvi, where are you? Yes, Madhvi, go ahead with your question.
So, my question is addressed to the both of you. So, why can't the leading political parties in India adopt the practices that are adopted in liberal democracies such as the US and Europe, where these politicians who have charges against them, criminal charges against them, they are dropped by these political parties themselves from fighting elections. In India, these elements are given tickets. I mean, for example, today Yediyurappa was given a ticket. And if you look at the Congress also, Suresh Kalmadi's wife is a very strong contender for getting a ticket.
Yeah.
So why?
Good question. Good question, and I'll take it to both of you. That you know, so much.
Yediyurappa's party first.
Please. Okay, Yediyurappa's party, but also coming to Suresh Kalmadi's party
Suresh
after.
Kalmadi,
yeah,
and their allies, A. Raja, and the whole works.
You made him into an ally of ours now.
Well, he was an ally to. The scam happened when he was in government.
Prime Minister defended Mr. Raja
Yediyurappa from Shimoga announced on the same day as Chandan Mitra from Hooghly.
Nothing proved against Mr. Yediyurappa. Lokayukta has cleared him.
But the cases are going on. The Supreme Court is still monitoring the case. It
just
refused to watch the proceedings.
You know, Barkha, let's face it.
Yeah.
Just because some cases were lodged against Mr. Narendra Modi, for 12 years, there was this demonology constructed around Narendra Modi by the
media. I'm not asking about Narendra Modi right now. Narendra Modi is not facing any case right now. Yediyurappa is.
Yeah, he will face. If he is convicted, obviously he can't.
Are you uncomfortable? No. There are leaders in your party. Sushma Swaraj has gone public, for example, questioning some of the allies that the BJP is courting.
I think it's very good. Will somebody in the Congress dare to question some of the alliances they have made?
Are you comfortable with Mr. Yediyurappa being back in the family?
No, it's not a question of my personal comfort or not.
Yeah.
It is not. I'm sure Shashi will agree with this. That even there are cases where you may or may not agree with what party decides, in the interest of party discipline, you whatever you have to say, I'll say in the party. I won't come out.
Same question for the Congress.
Rahul
Gandhi sharing.
Where is the conviction of Mr. Kalmadi? And what is more, even Mrs. Kalmadi? Mrs. Kalmadi is not even charged with anything.
Well, she's being a proxy candidate for Suresh Kalmadi. I mean, she's not.
Who has also not been convicted of anything. So the same answer that Chandan is giving.
But then what the voter is seeing is that it doesn't matter what charges are framed. When it comes to elections, it is winnability that matters. It is not corruption. Well, then where is this corruption debate? What is it all about?
No, it's about certainly raising the standards of public life and public discourse. But we have a phenomenon in our country where the media tends to act as prosecutor, judge and executioner without due process of law in many instances.
Not just in corruption,
in many aspects of our lives.
Yeah.
And I think we should also let the judicial system make the final determination as to whether somebody is guilty of something rather than letting the media do it. Now, in this particular instance, the voters will judge whether the preponderance of evidence the media has unleashed suggests that the person is actually guilty before the judge declares him or her guilty. Right. That will happen in some cases. I think we can all recall cases, I don't want to take names, of people who before they were convicted lost elections because the media had convinced the public that this person had indeed taken money or done other shameful things. Now, ultimately in a democracy, the moment that person is convicted, he or she will have to resign from parliament. And as you know, party stood up and refused
to
overturn this law. Whereas there was actually a consensus.
You're talking about Rahul Gandhi tearing up the ordinance. The same ordinance that was created, some say, for Lalu Prasad Yadav, who is today in alliance with the Congress.
But you see, we're in alliance with a party, not just an individual.
But Lalu Prasad Yadav heads that party. How can you separate
that's
it from the party?
That's perfect. It's the set of values that he believes in and the loyalty he commands.
You don't even sound like you believe what you're saying. And your smile gives
you away. You are so cynical. No, I do believe what I'm saying, because the fact is that it's a party is much more than an individual.
I'm saying if Yediyurappa is an embarrassment to them, then this much-hyped ordinance torn as nonsense by Rahul Gandhi amounts to nothing if Lalu Prasad Yadav is back as your ally. That I'm just pointing out to the contradiction
he
of both of your positions.
He too has an appeal pending. Let's see if the appeal is upheld.
See?
Okay.
There you are.
Let's move on to the next question.
Thank you for giving me the answer.
Ayush, babe. Yeah.
My question to Mr. Tharoor is that you're one of my role models.
Thank
you're
you.
You're probably one of the reasons why I came to St. Stephen in the first place.
Thanks.
So, and there are many like you in your party. So why is it that we have to look at a certain Rahul Gandhi who has no sort of administrative experience per se? You have had your share of administrative experience, right? So why is it that we have to look up to him as our Prime Minister or possibly our Prime Minister post-election? And my question for Mr. Chandan Mitra is that one of the most decorated credentials of Mr. Modi is that he's a decisive leader. But given the fact that we are in an era of coalitions, compromises have to be made, right? Like you made in Karnataka with Mr. Yediyurappa, where you had to bring him back. So do you think that A, Mr. Modi had the has the finesse and the sort of ability to bring everyone on board?
Okay, let's go to you first. Why do you have to look at a Rahul Gandhi who has no administrative experience? Why is the top job in the Congress reserved? How can Rahul Gandhi go on talking about changing the system when he is the system?
No, that's a little unfair. He's not, in fact, on the contrary, he says that one of the things that he's conscious of is that he is where he is because of a family name. No, the political leadership is not the same as bureaucratic leadership. Political choices are not just about resumes. Rahul Gandhi is a charismatic, nationally recognized figure. He is somebody who is a unifying figure within our party.
He has among the worst attendances in Parliament. And he talks about returning power to the lawmaker. We have seen Rahul Gandhi, except in the last few months, virtually invisible inside Parliament.
Not one question asked.
Not one question asked.
No, but see, those are measures that fundamentally are irrelevant to the question of a political leader in a party, because there are others of us whose job it is to ask and answer questions as well. We have
Shashi, the reason it's not irrelevant is because of Rahul Gandhi's own statement that one of the changes he believes is in returning power back to the lawmaker.
No, the lawmakers
are sitting in Parliament. He doesn't attend Parliament. When he does, he doesn't speak.
No, but what happens in Parliament? What has the BJP allowed us to do in Parliament throughout these last 5 years? You know, I came to Parliament
your
full of
own party member, your minister is in the well of the house.
That's only on Telangana, Andhra.
How many sessions
did the BJP completely wash out
minister,
the whole JPC issue?
In the well of the house.
We need a new consensus amongst the parties
before,
to make Parliament function.
BJP was in power and you're doing it now.
Your question now. Narendra Modi is not Vajpayee. That's what the young man there is saying. That Vajpayee had his Advani and Advani had his Vajpayee, and you had the yin and the yang of the party when the NDA was in power. Mr. Modi is trying to be both the Vikas Purush and the Loh Purush, to borrow from Venkaiah Naidu, who coined these constructs. Yeah. Do we need to see a softer side of Mr. Modi?
I don't understand why, you know, we are facing this question again and again. I don't think people know Mr. Modi well enough.
But isn't that a problem? I mean, he's a prime ministerial candidate.
You will get to know him. Let him become Prime Minister. It's a matter of just a matter of weeks. Look, it's a matter of weeks, and then
you have a divisive figure versus a unifying figure in the Congress party.
And
that's a big.
You called him charismatic. I rest my case.
All right. Next question from Raghav.
Have you seen him in a college audience, by the way? I've seen him. He absolutely inspires young people. You should bring him to St. Stephen's. You'll see for yourself.
Those of you who believe Rahul Gandhi, we have not heard from Rahul Gandhi enough in Parliament, raise your hand. We have not heard from Rahul Gandhi in Parliament. Shashi, this is what the young people say, and I'm going to get this young girl in the blue skirt here.
The thing is, as you know, as a young person, I can't trust Congress at this moment. The leader whom you are portraying as a prime ministerial candidate.
Or not, actually, because he's not even being officially portrayed as that.
I can't trust him. I don't see him speaking. Whenever he's there, he just has some rehearsed lines which he's speaking. And one more thing, why Congress always targets Modi on 2002 elections or riots, when you also have 1984 riots? You also have a past. So why target somebody on the basis of riots?
The fact is, 84 is something that most of us in the Congress party have condemned. I'm on record in 84 and since in my books and writings. I condemn it unreservedly. My party president and prime minister have apologized to the nation and to the Sikh community for what happened in 84. We have never sought to defend it.
After how many years?
We have done so. Whereas 2002, sadly, you know, it's like, frankly, the situation where there's a very black American joke about the person, you know, after President Lincoln was assassinated in the theater. And somebody goes to Mrs. Lincoln and says, but apart from that, did you enjoy the play?
Hey, well, Mr. Modi, do you believe that the Arvind Kejriwal, agree or disagree with him, has shown more gumption in trying to take on Narendra Modi than the Congress has in Gujarat for years?
See, but that's not our style of politics. Frankly, K.
Kejriwal's kind of politics is what you guys in the media want, Varka. Let's be honest. You know, we have every single...
Why would we want it?
Because it's good theatre. It raises your TRPs. You see this fellow creating a ruckus. People are throwing stones. People are being barricaded outside the house. This is great stuff for you.
I tend to agree.
For us,
you tend
for
to
us, honestly, on Gujarat, every single criticism of Gujarat's development model has been brought out in facts
you
and figures by the Congress.
The it's of you're no not interest being able to convince the voters.
Because your media won't give us any airtime. You're not interested in showing that. If we had gone and created half the ruckus, you'd have given us the same attention. It's not our style.
Check the next question. Raghav, where are you? Raghav, yes.
It's very commonly said that the president that you've made should have not been the president, but should have been the PM. And that there's definitely...
You're talking about Pranab Mukherjee.
Yeah.
Okay.
And there's definitely a dearth of senior leadership that is definitely seen in the Congress, or it's projected that's very prominent amongst the youth. So how is it that Congress takes this? What are your views on this? And second, if you happen to lose the forthcoming elections, what do you think is it going to be? Anti-Congress votes that's going to make BJP win? Or it's actually people wanting BJP that should
is
make
Manmohan
BJP
Singh
win?
The best polling agent for Narendra Modi, and, as is often said? Let him answer now.
No, first of all, no, I don't buy into that phraseology at all, Barkha. But let me go directly to his question. He's actually asking, do we have a dearth of leadership in the Congress party? And the answer is very bluntly, no. In fact, I think one of the great strengths of the Congress is that we have a deep front bench and an even deeper back bench of people, young and old, with experience and action.
Why is the top job of your party reserved?
Because the party picks the one who most appeals across the party lines, and that's what at the moment we've got. But let me just come back to this. What does the BJP have by comparison against the tried and tested veterans, both young and old, of the Congress party, who've actually shown what they're capable of, whether it's the Chidambaram generation or whether it's the Jyotiradithya Scindia Sachin Pilot generation?
But neither Chidambaram nor Scindia would ever be made PM candidates.
But the point is, a government is not, we don't have run a presidential system, Barkha. We have a parliamentary system. People have responsibilities in different ministries. We have the depth of leadership in the Congress that the BJP simply doesn't have available to offer.
I'm afraid this is entirely incorrect. We have a much, much more experienced and much more responsible people who are given the relevant responsibility in the BJP. You look at the entire bench from Sushma Swaraj, Arun Jaitley, and we can carry on.
But when it comes to dynasty, as the mentor, all your allies, all of your allies have a problem, whether it's the Akalis, whether it's the Thackerays, whether it's the Paswans. I mean, these are all your allies. They're all dynasts. So why do you only attack the Congress for dynasty?
Thank you, Varka.
No, because...
First fair regional question.
Oh, come on.
You know, regional parties...
Yes.
Regional parties, when they are working in consort with us, a party
the
like the BJP...
You can't call Rahul Gandhi Shehzada unless you also acknowledge that Sukhbir Singh Badal is a Shehzada.
Sukhbir Singh Badal is not...
Is he a Shehzada?
Such a major player.
Is he a Shehzada? Is he a Shehzada?
No, I would not call him
is
Shehzada.
Is he a Shehzada?
No, but I wouldn't call him a Shehzada, because Shehzada is reserved for the occupant of the, or would be wannabe occupant of Delhi Masnad, a throne. That person is a Shehzada.
So you're saying that these dynasts are too small?
They are state leaders, and the parties have always been family oriented. And I think it's an entirely different matter. Congress party, the oldest party in this country, the biggest party in this country, spread all over our 29 states.
Yeah.
And why
okay,
they must have
only
one family?
How many of
family?
You would want to join politics but are scared away by the thought that you're not actually the son or the daughter of a politician, that only dynasty works? How many of you think only dynasty still works or is driving our politics? There's very few hands going up. Let's hear from this young girl here in
so
the front.
They're all joining BJP.
They're all joining BJP?
BJP.
How
yes.
do you know?
Listen, I didn't have anybody in my family in politics, so you don't have
not
to join the BJP to be a non-dynastic
politician. I'm certainly
politician.
Not joining BJP or Congress, because as she gave the example of Sukhbir Singh Badal, you cannot say that it's a regional party and I won't consider, because that's Punjab and this is Delhi. Sukhbir Singh Badal is definitely a Shehzada, and so is Rahul Gandhi. And for Rahul Gandhi, forget about the parliament attendance, he didn't even have college attendance. So
you seem to know a lot about him. Clearly he's inspired a lot of interest on your part.
He hasn't inspired me.
So who so who inspires you?
Barkha Tut inspires me.
Oh, okay. I swear, I don't even know her name, lest I be accused of planting that question, but thank
so Barkha,
you.
Barkha, why didn't you run for president?
I told you when I got out of the car, I said, till you get your ticket, we'll hold the fort for you.
I much prefer being on this side. It's actually easier. I must say, I have to make a statement in respect of politicians and for the political process. it's actually quite difficult to be a politician.
Yes.
Because it's very little gain and a lot of pain. Okay, Henry Gomes. Henry, where are you?
Now, at a time when regional politics is overpowering national politics, we often find that the Iron Man, Sardar Patel's virtues are neglected or long forgotten, and the focus is a little elaborate on the Gandhi-Nehru family and their contributions after the Indian independence. So what are your views on it with regard to the recent example of the Statue of Unity that Mr. Modi built, saying reinstating Sardar Patel's virtues of national integration?
I'm a huge admirer of Sardar Patel. I've written about him as well as I have about Nehru. But the fact is that to our mind, it's not Patel who's the issue. It's the attempt by the Modi brigade to appropriate the Patel legacy for a man who's very unlike him. And I pointed out before, and I'll do so again, that the best contrast is to see how Sardar Patel behaved during the riots that accompanied partition in 47, and how Mr. Modi behaved as Chief Minister of Gujarat in 2002. Because here you have Sardar Patel, who actually is very much identified with a certain wing of the Congress Party, and he goes out and tries to prevent riots. He herds in vulnerable Muslim groups into the Red Fort and ensures they're protected. He decides that because local security forces might be infected by the prevailing communal passions, he brings soldiers over from Pune and Madras.
On the count the list, the 220 people were shot dead by the Gujarat police during the riots.
And Sardar Patel goes to Nizamuddin and prays to show that Muslims are a part of our society. What did Modi do?
Those shot in Gujarat were from the majority community. And they were, army came out of the streets within 48 hours of the riots.
48 hours is not correct.
Come on. And what happened in 84? This barracks for three full days. 3,500 people burned to death mostly.
My question, Shashi, is a little bit different when it comes to the legacy of Sardar Patel. Is there a belated awakening because the BJP has appropriated Sardar Patel as a symbol? Look at what's happening. You have Lal Bahadur Shastri's grandson and Rajmohan Gandhi. You have, you know, the Gandhi legacy and the Shastri legacy actually moving to a party like the Aam Aadmi Party.
No, look, I like and respect Rajmohan Gandhi, but he has contested many elections and never once for the Congress Party, going back three or four decades.
Against Rajiv Gandhi.
So I think that's not a particularly new phenomenon. And look, we are not claiming in a democracy that any one party has a monopoly of virtue. We certainly feel, however, that we stand for the right values and principles in our society.
Okay, I have time just for a couple more questions and we have to end. Sneha, Felix.
My question is to Mr. Mitra. BJP's foundational ideology of Hindutva is getting blurred with the rhetoric of development.
Look, first of all, I want to tell you that BJP, you will not find the word Hindutva anywhere in BJP, its constitution, its literature, nowhere.
They speak hypocritically of Gandhian socialism. That's their alleged founding ideology.
Socialism.
What is Gandhian socialism?
Again, Gandhi is not your monopoly.
Is that an acknowledgement?
No, Gandhi is not your monopoly.
Is that an acknowledgement that Hindutva has no resonance, no political resonance like it did in the 90s?
But if Narendra Modi says Gandhian socialism, I think the rest of us are really going to find it very hard not to choke.
Very defined concept when V. Savarkar wrote about it.
What is Hindutva for the BJP today? What is it?
Hindutva is Indianness.
Why should Hindutva be Indianness?
As Advani ji has said,
Indianness is many religions, not one.
See, the core of the Indian civilization, as it existed 5,000 years ago and even earlier, has been Hindutva. It has been defined by that.
Do you think this generation will accept that Hindutva is?
Doesn't matter. Hindutva does not mean
when you were 18 years old in this college, did you believe that Hindutva was one of the defining identities of India?
I was not enlightened.
Never saw him in khaki shorts.
Let's put this.
Would have been a sight, Dajan.
Do any of you here believe that Hindutva is a principle that the BJP should pursue? Is Hindutva a principle that the BJP should pursue? You think they should? Yes.
As per Jawaharlal Nehru's book, he has defined that Hindutva is not basically means the religion Hindu. Hindu means anyone who lives on that side of the river Indus. So it's not identifiable with the religion. It's identifiable with the geographical population in this area.
Quick response to that, and then I have to take a last question.
That is the origin of the word Hindu, because it was actually not a word we made up in India. It was made up by foreigners to describe people who lived on the other side of the Indus. But the fact is, when the BJP says Hindu, they mean people who profess the Hindu religion.
You don't belong to the BJP. How do you know what BJP
is? Because I read yours. I've read the very people you've talked about. I've read the very people you've talked about. Plus, I've read the Indira.
First, join the BJP. Practice our faith. Then you will know what we mean.
Okay. But
practice our faith. He has just condemned himself. Practice our faith, sir.
Practice
our faith means what? Practice our faith means?
What?
I practice your faith. I don't practice your politics.
I'm hardly a religious man. You know that very well.
What is the Ram Mandir movement?
Yeah, it's there. It's also along with that. I mean, what is wrong?
Okay.
There's a development stream and there is, a cultural stream.
Okay,
and
we have Ram Mandir
is now on the back burner because...
I'm a Hindu and destroying other people's places of worship is not my culture.
Course,
not a cultural stream as far as I'm concerned.
This is... Okay. I don't agree, but that will open up a very long debate.
Let's take the last question. Sanjana, where are you? You had a question on the cricket players, I believe, in UP. Yes, go ahead. Sanjana.
So, the mere act of supporting a cricket team has led to sedition charge. So, this is indicative of serious discontent. So, how does the BJP plan to address the undeniable presence of trust deficit that exists with the Kashmiri population if it comes to power? And how is it different from the stand of the Congress regarding
this? Okay, Chandan, let's start with you. Does the BJP support the sedition charges have been withdrawn now against these students who were backing Pakistan? There was somebody who wrote in from Chennai, said that the entire Chennai stadium gave a standing ovation to Pakistan when the Pakistan team won. Were they all going to be slapped with sedition?
Look, firstly, I think facts must be clear. Nobody has been slapped sedition charges for applauding Afridi. Sedition was because they raised the slogan Pakistan Zindabad in the hostel premises. And I believe anybody sitting in this country, breathing its air, drinking its water and eating its food, uses such seditious slogans and says Pakistan Zindabad must be charged with sedition and tried in court.
But Chandan, the fact of the matter is that many young Kashmiris do not even want to be part of the Indian Union. Well, if your party comes to power, you will have to deal with this politically. L.K. Advani, as Deputy Prime Minister, met with the Hurriyat Conference in a meeting that I reported on.
To bring people to the political mainstream, the BJP went out of its way. Atal Bihari Vajpayee
went to Kashmir.
It was he who started the Lahore bus service.
But you support the sedition charges?
No, if you can't sit here and shout Pakistan Zindabad, sorry.
Shashi?
No, first of all, these students were in UP because of a UPA government scheme, a Congress government-led scheme, to integrate the Kashmiris into Indian society and change the mindset that leads them to say things like Pakistan Zindabad. By locking people up in jail, you're not going to suppress their thoughts.
Do you support the sedition charges? You didn't answer.
No, I don't think that there should have been any sedition charges. And what is more, I don't think it is seditious to support any cricket team of your choice at any point in our country.
So, Chandan, have they supported Bangladesh or Afghanistan or?
Look, it's not. It's not the same thing.
Yes.
India and Pakistan, there is a long history and tradition of kind of.
But is the answer a sedition law?
No, sedition is not necessary. Frankly,
yeah.
Whether sedition law, specifically law of sedition, should be slapped in this day and age, I am myself not very sure.
Okay.
But some legal action needs to be taken because there must be something punitive that this cannot go scot-free and they cannot be treated.
Okay, let's leave it there. Both of you get 30 seconds each as we end to tell these young voters why they should vote for your party. I will time this. These are your last comments. Maximum 40 seconds. Starting now, Chandan Mitra, first you. Why should a young voter vote the BJP today?
Well, I think BJP is a party which not just promises pipe dreams, but actually promises development, avenues and kind of the growth of India. And we did it during 6 years of Mr. Vajpayee's regime. And opportunities are going to open up. We have to make India not just an emerging power, an emergent power. BJP had made it an emerging power, but it has slipped to build India again, to assure your own future.
Okay.
In chosen disciplines.
Your 30 seconds are up.
Yes, okay. You must vote BJP to make us an emerging nation again.
Shashi.
The fact is, folks, you're living in an India that has been changed dramatically by the 10 years of UPA rule, which have actually transformed the face of our country. Everything from the Right to Information Act, you can now take for granted the accountability of your elected representatives, to the Right to Education Act. There are kids in school who would never otherwise have been there. Everything we've done to help the rural poor, the Mahatma Gandhi Rural Employment Guarantee Scheme. We're transforming India. The majority of Indians' lives are actually better because of UPA policies.
vote for building an India that will help fulfill your aspirations,
okay,
and not for
up.
Notions of power and so on, which frankly at this stage we shouldn't be focusing on. Let's make India better before we exercise power.
We will leave it there. You, the voter, will have the last word. For now, it's time to say thank you to both Chandan Mitra and Shashi Tharoor. Let's have a big round of applause for them. Two former presidents of the union here looking ahead to another election. Thank you so much for joining us on Politics.